Senate has approved the proposed 822 billion peso budget of the Department of Public Works and Highways for next year. It's actually the biggest among all other department budget allocations for next year. Now, the money will be distributed to five main programs: Asset Preservation Project, Network Development Project, Bridge Program and Rehabilitation Project, Flood Management and Convergence and Special Supports. It also challenged the funding for flood mitigation and drainage projects of around 203 billion, saying more should be done to improve them and make them more efficient. Lawmakers also reminding the agency to make sure that over 86% of the budget of a specific project must go to the project itself, while only around 13% must go to the contractors and administration. The country's nearly 180,000 motor vehicle license plates backlog expected to be cleared by this Wednesday, November 15th. The Philippine Land Transportation Office gives this assurance, saying around 990,000 motor vehicle plates are set to be released. The 13 million backlog in motorcycle plates, though, may take until 2025 to fully resolve. Meanwhile, the LTO says almost 5 million driver's license cards are expected to arrive next year. This will help fill the 2.4 million backlogs for 2023. Under the proposed 2024 budget, the agency will receive an additional 297 million pesos for the purchase of driver's license cards. The Philippine government temporarily waives import duties on some raw materials used for construction. Executive Order No. 46 has approved the recommendation of the National Economic and Development Authority Board to cut the tariff on imported gypsum and anhydrite from the current 3% to 0% for 5 years. Malacañang says this move will help revitalize and increase the competitiveness of the local plasterboard and cement industries, adding it will also support housing and infrastructure projects in the country. The order will take effect 30 days after publication and will be reviewed yearly starting 2025. 85% of Filipinos support the country's shift to renewable energy, this amid spiking electricity prices as well as environmental concerns. Lady Vicencio tells us more.
Majority of Filipinos believe it is important to increase the use of renewable energy in the country. In a Pulse Asia survey commissioned by Strathbase ADR Institute, 85% or 17 out of 20 Filipinos see the importance of using renewable energy sources such as solar, wind, and hydropower. The survey also showed how respondents from Metro Manila and Visayas showed strong favor on renewable energy, with more than 90% of respondents voting on the affirmative. Ateneo de Manila University Associate Professor Dr. Mahalea Ravagos sees climate change as a factor of the turnout due to adverse effects in the past extreme weather events in these areas. Metro Manila and some Visayas provinces were listed by Cross-Dependency Initiative as among the most vulnerable regions in the Philippines for climate change.
Interesting din yung sa Visayas region, yes. Na mataas din, di ba? Mm-hmm. That may also be because of their experience with Yolanda. Kasi they had that first-hand experience, di ba? Mm-hmm. So, and yun yung tsunami, yung parang tsunami-like, di ba? So, yeah, yung storm surge na nag-emerge lang during that Yolanda. So, isa din yung possible reason na kung bakit yung concerns for climate change mas nakikita sa kanila.
Aside from environmental concerns, Ravago said, electricity prices are higher on average in areas with electric cooperatives as power distributors. Even with more renewable energy plants, it is vital for the government to ensure that bottlenecks in transmission are addressed.
Minsan, yung mga residents in the region, di ba, especially sa Visayas na merong geothermal or sa kahit sa Iloilo na andaming sa Ilocos na andaming renewable, sasabihin nila, andito tong mga to pero ang mahal ng electricity sa atin. Kasi yung generation companies na yun, once it's injected in the system, hindi naman sa kanila necessary madideliver yung electricity. It's the co-op who's contracting with other generation companies that dictates the price that is being charged on the consumer. consumer for that particular region.
The Energy Department said it is coordinating with various government agencies to ensure that transmission lines are in place to connect renewable energy plants to power distributors. Experts are also urging the government to prioritize the streamlining of business processes and easing of regulatory requirements to attract investors for renewable energy sources.
I-unlock natin yung mga barriers to the RE development, permits, licensing, syempre yung presence ng infrastructure, no? Either distribution system or yung tinatawag natin transmission facility, no? Para sa grid interconnection. On the policy side, meron tayong tinatawag na voluntary and mandatory policy mechanism. Ito yung market development support natin dun sa mga investors or tinatawag nating RE developers, kasi hindi naman sila magtatayo ng planta kung walang bibili or walang kukuha dun sa kanilang generation.
The National Renewable Energy Program aims to increase the country's renewable energy share in the generation mix to 30% by 2030 and 50% by 2050. Lady Vicencio, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Energy Regulatory Commission set to reduce transmission charges in the second quarter of 2024. The DOE's budget sponsor, Senator Sherwin Gatchalian, revealed this during the agency's budget hearing on Tuesday. Gatchalian, however, clarified the amount to be deducted is still being finalized.
The probability of seeing a significant reduction in our transmission charge is quite high. As to how much it is reduction, that's still being calculated, but it will be significant. In terms of modality, I was advised that it's easier to reduce the rates. And it's easier to do that. It's easier to monitor, it's either to apply, and it's either for the regulator to supervise the implementation of that reduction. So the regulator prefers that modality for ease of administration.
The Philippine Senate has approved the proposed 2024 budget of the DOE amounting to 1.6 billion pesos. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. names veteran banker Rafael Consing Jr. as the president and CEO of the Maharlika Investment Corporation, which will manage the country's first ever sovereign wealth fund. Consing is known for his stints as CFO of Enrique Vazon's ICTSI and as treasurer of Aboitiz Equity Ventures. Jackie Pascual tells us more.
Former Aboitiz and ICTSI executive Rafael Consing Jr. has been appointed by President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. as the first president and CEO of Maharlika Investment Corporation. Consing is the executive director of the Office of the Presidential Advisor for Investment and Economic Affairs. Prior to this, he has been working in the private sector. The Presidential Communication Office described Consing as accomplished, results-driven, and multi-awarded, who has experiences in various areas of economics and finance. Consing will now be in charge of the multi-billion peso sovereign wealth fund and will establish a diversified portfolio of investments locally and abroad. MIC will have a 125 billion peso initial capitalization, which will come from the National Government, Land Bank, and Development Bank of the Philippines. Albay representative and economist Joey Salceda welcomed the appointment of Consing, calling him the man for the job. RCBC chief economist Michael Ricafort added that Consing's job in the private sector will help him in his new role, especially since he used to handle infrastructure projects.
Veterano na po siya na former international banker, tapos dati rin siyang chief finance officer ng yung pinakamalaking port operator. Nandoon po yung expertise pagdating po sa developmental side.
UP economist JC Punungbayan, however, questions why the implementing rules and regulations have to be revised seemingly to accommodate Consing.
Nirelax nila yung qualifications para sa president and CEO ng Maharlika Investment Corporation. Dati nakalagay na dapat merong advanced degree sa economics or sa finance, pero tinanggal yon dun sa bagong implementing rules and regulations. And it turns out na itong si Rafael Consing ay walang advanced degree when it comes to these fields.
Punong Bayan acknowledges Consing's experiences but said the IRR revision must still ensure transparency in using the fund.
Pera ng taong bayan itong ilalagay dito sa Maharlika Investment Fund. Kaya dapat nandyan lahat ng mga provisions para masiguro na hindi makukurakot at ma-audit at very transparent at accountable yung officers.
Rica Ford said Consing does not need to have an advanced degree given his wealth of experiences. Monetary Board member and former National Treasurer Rosalia De Leon also defended the removal of qualifications of directors at the IRR, asserting that it will give more independence to the board to determine the specific qualifications of the officers of the MIC and ensure it will not be politically driven. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.